Parashat Chukat. The problem really is, and the biggest problem of the parasha, what is the nature of Moses' sin that makes it so severe that he cannot enter the land of Israel? That he struck the rock and didn't speak to the rock? Well, in the book of Exodus, God commands Moses to take the staff and to strike the rock. After all, once before, and more than once before, the Jews cried about water. And it certainly is a very big miracle if you strike a rock and water comes out of a rock. And that's what Moses was told to do and what he did in Shemot. Now in Bamidbar, granted, 39 years later. But in Bamidbar, he is once again commanded to take the staff, but speak to the rock. Why is it such a grave sin if he struck the rock this time? According to the Rambam, the sin was not striking the rock. The sin was how he referred to the Israelites. Shimuna Hamorim, listen now, you rebels. I want to explain something else. In the book of Exodus, in the beginning of the sojourn in the desert, the Jews complain about the lack of water, about the lack of food, and God always understands. In chapter 11 of Bamidbar, Vayehi ha'am kimit onenim rab oznei Hashem, the Jews were kvetching evilly before God. Here, God is not so happy with them. And God is also angry at them. Why is it that in the book of Exodus, he accepts their whining? And in the book of Numbers, he does not. And the answer is a very simple one. In the book of Exodus, they didn't have food and they didn't have water. They were crying for necessities. God understands that. You can't live without food and water. Here, at this point in the book of Numbers, earlier on in the book of Numbers, in chapter 11 of the book of Numbers, they already had food, the man. And they didn't lack for water. In chapter 11, they wanted a change in menu. They wanted meat. They wanted watermelon. They wanted leeks. They wanted garlic. They were whining and kvetching because there wasn't a sufficient variety in their menu. God gets angry. Now here, they're asking for water again. You weren't rebels. If you need water, you cannot live for 3 days without water. So when Moses calls them rebels, he's showing a certain kind of disgust with the people. He's tired of them already. He's looking at them with different eyes. Now look at the language. God says to Moses, "Kach et hamateh v'hakel et ha'edah." Take your staff and gather the witness community. Eida is a witness community. The Jews are a witness community, witnesses to God. The Jews may sometimes whine and sometimes kvetch, but the Jews put their lives on the line for freedom. The Jews maintain their fundamental tradition despite Egypt and servitude. The Jews are God's witnesses on earth that God wants compassionate righteousness and moral justice. The Jews are a very special people. Gather the witness community. Speak to the rock, and here, almost like a Freudian dream, the rock represents the stiff-necked nation that can be stubborn in a good sense. They don't give up on their traditions. Venatan Meimav, and the rock, Israel, the nation, will give forth water. If you speak to the nation the words of the oral law, if you respect the nation as a witness community, if you speak up to them, if you guide them to be ever more righteous and committed, they will produce the water, the life-giving waters, because Torah is also compared to water. And then v'hishkita et ha'eda v'et bi'iram, you will then be able to have plenty of water. Regular water, H2O, for the witness community and for their animals. What did Moses and Aaron do? Vayakilu Moshe v'Aaron et ha'kahal. They gathered the aggregate group. A kahal is a rabble. Hordes. Not a witness community. Moses was disgusted, not only with their whining. He was disgusted because when Korach rebelled against him, not one person came to his defense. Disgusted because Datan and Aviram still wanted to return to Egypt after everything that he had done for them in freeing them from Egyptian slavery. He felt that this was an aggregate, arrogant group of ingrates who didn't appreciate what he had done for them. And so he calls them rebels. And so he can't look at them as a witness community. He looks upon them as a kahal, as hordes. And God says, you can't lead them into Egypt, into Israel. Because the person who leads the Jews must believe in the Jews, must lift them up, must see them as a witness community. If he sees them as ingrates, it's not going to help. And therefore, it wasn't so much a punishment as it was a necessary result of the fact that he had lost confidence in his people. He no longer loved them, no longer respected them, and therefore could no longer lead them. Shabbat Shalom.